to bear.
In peace. Is there joy in peace? And I thought that there was joy in suffering. Aren't those some of the lessons we've looked at recently? Looking at the open up the beginning of your joy in adversity, I guess is what they. But now there's joy in peace.
That was back.
What's that?
Back a week or so.
Well, that was, yes, that was September the 12th. But I'm just trying to point out, we say there's joy in adversity, now we say there's joy in peace. You know, it almost seems like they're trying to tell you there's joy in everything.
Joy in knowing Jesus, there's a good one.
There is. There is.
We should have the joy of the Lord no matter what happens to us.
That's right. That's right.
Whatever we have to go through, we know He's walking with us.
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. Well, how many of you have been distressed? Are you joyful? Anybody had any stresses this past week? Anybody get on your last nerve? Anything get on your last nerve?
Be careful, Clyde. Be careful.
You might be your joy.
With my own self because I can't do a lot of things I used to do. So I get kind of upset about things like that, but I don't have no one to pick at, so I have to pick it myself.
Well, I just mentioned it because there is joy and peace. It's nice when things are peaceful. You know, I don't like stormy stuff going on in my life. So, I mean, the lesson almost doesn't need to be explained when you say that there's joy and peace. There certainly is joy and peace. When there isn't any sort of stress and there isn't any sort of...
Everybody's getting along.
Absolutely, there's complete harmony. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
There's joy through peace. I guess I should make the emphasis on through peace rather than in peace. And so the lesson is trying to encourage us to seek peace. There will be joy through peace. And I guess I've just been trying to stress that there is not joy when you're not at peace. If you're distressed, you're not going to have peace. And I raised the question, I mean, I don't mean to keep beating this drum, because I know that I was really hurt this past week, still am. And all the people that I continue to just help out, you know, mowing grass, and they don't even have the courtesy to say thank you.
Yeah. It gets to you.
Well, it does. I've been at it now for 24 and a half years. You know, you'd think that somebody would open up their door and look at you and say, yeah, I really appreciate this. And understand, you don't do it once for a lifetime. That's like looking at your wife at the marriage altar and say, I love you, and never saying it to her again. And if she ever starts to get a little distressed, you look at her and say, well, I told you 50 years ago, it hadn't changed. If it does, I'll let you know.
I'm sorry, honey.
He tells me all.
Well, and it makes a difference.
Yeah,
it makes a difference. And I know that y'all get tired. I really get distressed about it because I can't tell you the amount of time that I've spent, energy. I feel like saying to these people, you want to know what it feels like? Go down and buy yourself a mower. Wait a minute. That's going to cost me money. You don't think I got mine for free? You buy the fuel for it. You come and spend your time. You end up doing all the cutting for it. And then... after you're done, I'm going to walk right past you and never say thank you. And you're going to do it the next week and you think, this time he's going to say something. No, doesn't say anything. And the next week, doesn't say anything. And I know y'all say, well, then just stop doing it. I get tired of living in a pig pen where I live. Because that's the community. I hate to say it. That's the community I live in. I know that all this is being recorded. I've got a couple good neighbors out there, and I'll go ahead and throw this in. Denise Lombardi, Phyllis Lemasters, appreciate them because they actually care about the community. Everybody else, I mean, they absolutely, Sheila lives down the street. You're out of this conversation, Sheila. She lives far enough down, she's not considered. But am I right? Am I overstating it? Do they live like pigs?
Yes.
I paid her to say that. No, I mean, the trash and stuff. Let me just take a time out here. Y'all may say, lay off of it. I talked with a police officer here a little over a week ago. I did a yard sale and talked to a police officer. He came by. Officer, DJ, let's say Casto, Dan is his name. And he was talking about that the people down at the apartment, and granted, they're at another level. It was turning into a dump behind their house, literally. I mean, you name it, it was back there. In fact, he had to go and talk with them. He stood there at the back door talking with them, and he said, I stood while I was talking there behind those apartment buildings, and looked in that backyard. He says, I counted 22 rats playing in the yard. We're talking rats as you weren't aware of this. That's what he told me. And I tell you what, I would drive my car around the corner and see all the trash cans, and I would see the rats running all over the place. Literally. So when I say a dump, I literally mean it. Okay? By the way, I understand that he ordered me to get it cleaned up, and then they put all the stuff on a truck for it. And I understand they're supposed to be getting evicted or something like that. And I don't like to see people get evicted. But I'm just saying, it's one of those things that it really bugs me. And I can testify, tie this back into the lesson, if you're not at peace, you're not going to have joy. It's one of those things, it's going to eat on you. And I don't care if it's something like that or if it's a relational issue. Have any of y'all been on the outs with somebody recently? Maybe family, maybe neighbor, maybe a shopper, person that drives slow on the road. Certain people of political offices that come on television that... Why'd you do that? What happened to your peace?
I'm Pete, I didn't have to listen.
I don't have to listen. Why did you turn it off? Because you say, I'm not going to have peace as long as I listen to all this garbage.
Right.
And so the Apostle Paul, I feel like, says, I understand something about joy. You will not have joy if you do not have peace. So he's encouraging people, seek peace. I know that, Miss Bessie, I'm always fearful whenever I send you one of the articles. I send her emails all the time, articles that I read. And I do hold back, you might find her, I believe, I hold back the vast majority of them run across. But at times I'm afraid to send to it because she says, you know, it gets depressing if you just read bad news after bad news. Mm-hmm. And it can absolutely wear you down. You know what I'm talking about. And so the Apostle Paul is writing to the church at Philippi, or at least this is what they're focusing on out of this passage of Scripture. Try to seek peace, because if you don't have peace, you're not going to have joy. It is a joy stealer if you don't have peace. And I raise that question because I'm led to believe, and I don't think you're being honest with me, I'm led to believe by the question that I asked earlier, have any of y'all had anything that gave you, stressed you out this past week? And y'all just sit there, no, not me. Well, maybe you've forgotten the stuff that made you stressed, but I can't believe that I'm the only person that ever gets stressed out during the course of a week.
I forget it?
Well, that's a good thing. I don't want to be encouraging you because as you focus on this, you're going to lose your joy.
I can't remember what all those emails said.
What emails?
grandpa doing anything wrong because she can't remember.
That's good.
Sounds like this is an ideal relationship. So, anyhow, just looking at our lesson, there are going to be four parts again to the lesson today. The first thing that he says that you can do to seek peace is to learn to stand. Stand what? Well, it's going to be stand firm in the Lord. That's the first thing. Then the second part of the lesson today on page 52, I take it back, it may not be, it's not page 52 in your book. Is page 48 in your book. Unite. Don't divide. Become more united. Don't work on putting more distance between yourself and the other people. Work on bringing people together. Unite. That will help to ensure peace. Third thing is pray. Does prayer work? God hears prayers. He does. The Apostle Paul says, don't forget to pray about it. And then the last point of today's lesson is dwell. Stay there. Stay there. Once you've put everything in place, refuse to budge. Take this prescription and make that your dwelling place. Okay? So that's going to be the four steps that the Apostle Paul is trying to encourage people to take in order to ensure peace within their lives. And again, I don't want to overstate it, but when you don't have peace, you're not going to have joy. And you know what goes on inside of you better than anybody else. And if you find that in your life you say, I'm not really joyful at this point. I bet that if you do some digging, you'll find the reason that you don't is because you don't have peace. There is something that is disturbing you. And you folks do look like a disturbed congregation. I'm just kidding. Just kidding. You look wonderful. Let's read the first passage of Scripture. Mary, you want to read the first one to us first about stand, but you can stay seated.
So then, my dearly loved and longed for brothers and sisters, my joy and crown in this matter, stand firm in the Lord, dear friends.
He's going to go on to the next part because he's pleading with these two women that they seem to have some spats that are going on. I have heard, or maybe should keep my mouth shut, but you know me, I'm not good about biting my tongue. I have heard that raising boys is so much easier than raising girls. I don't know if it's exactly true. I know that boys are bad about mischief and that sort of stuff. But what I've heard about girls, teenage girls are, they are the world's worst on backbiting and gossiping and all sorts. Is there any truth to this? I'm just reporting what I've heard. There's no truth to it at all. No truth at all.
No, I don't think so.
I was one.
Now, that was nearly 100 years ago, but I've actually heard this. That there, and I don't need to go too far, but there tends to be, let me give you something to think about. Girls tend to be more relational. You know, they have a tendency to need each other more. I mean, the girls, when they're growing up, they can't go to the bathroom by themselves. Would you like to go to the bathroom with me? It's for protection. But I'm just even saying, you know, the talking and everything like that, girls tend to be more verbal. You know, there was a study with that Hidden Keys, Love Your Relationships. Gary Smalley came out that video series probably at least around 30 years ago, I guess it was. And they actually did a study. I don't know who it was that did the study, but found that women, by and large, needed to speak like 30,000 words a day.
Oh, wow.
God deposit $10,000 or less. It's not uncommon for guys to be going down the road and we'll ride for.
You know why we do that?
Why?
We have to repeat it all for you guys.
Oh. That's it.
That's true. You have to repeat
she said,
it all for us
you
guys.
Guys.
Yeah.
You guys.
I don't feel like I'm getting anywhere with me trying to convince you about
I'm
this
sorry,
thing.
I'm picking at you today.
Right out of the bed.
Don't worry. He's
I'd be good this morning, but I'm not.
Don't worry. He's older. He'll forget to. Just like he said about you, that you forget. He'll forget to. No, I don't feel like I'm getting anywhere with this thing. But there were two women within the church. And oftentimes that's where a lot of, and I won't say it's just to the women because it can't happen with guys. But women tend to be more verbal. And there's friction within the church. And so what the Apostle Paul is saying then, he's trying to build this case for peace. He says the first thing that you need to do is stand firm in the Lord. The Lord is our pattern for every area of life. He is our hope for every, he's our strength. He is the one that is going to make things possible. So you and I need to look to the Lord for instruction. Lord, I want you to know, want you to help me to know how to handle this situation. And please, don't deny that there's problems when there's problems.
Everybody has problems. Sooner or later, I mean, you don't have a perfect life.
Exactly right. And so you look to the Lord first and foremost. This is what you do. Back years ago, when I was engaged, the minister that, you know, my fiance and I went to talk with, it was a pastor, he used the illustration. He said to the couple that was getting married, which was us, he said, within a Christian marriage, you put God, Jesus, first, he is at the top. It says if you could picture, you know, the bride down here and the groom here, said that as the two of them committed their lives to becoming like Jesus Christ, as they move closer to Christ, what happens to them?
They get closer.
Jesus does bring people together. And he is the one that's there instructing us of how we can get the peace, how we can regain the peace. You know, if you find friction, the Lord may say to you, yeah, you might need to do some fence mending here. You might need to do some building of bridges. If you're involved in something that, you know, is not pleasing the Lord will start to convict you. You're not going to have peace as long as you're doing what I would not do. And you're going to have to take your stand. You're going to say, well, that's going to put me at odds with the other person. And all that I will tell you is that when you stop doing things the way the Lord wants you to do them, you're not going to have peace with God. And it starts with God. And it's held together with God. And if you abandon God, you are not going to have peace. So this is the first and most important step, as far as I'm concerned, of this whole process that he's describing. You need to focus upon the Lord. I know he's using the expression, stand firm in the Lord. But you need to seek God's blessing and God's direction in the situations that you're dealing with. You deal with it on your own, in your own way, you're going to make things worse. Stand firm in the Lord. Know what your commitment is. I asked you to be my Lord, not just my Savior. I asked you to be the one to tell me what I need to hear, whether I want to hear it or not. Stand firm in the Lord. That means that the Lord is the one that's most important in this equation. It's not my feelings. It's not the other person's feelings. It's about pleasing the Lord. So he says, my dearly loved, longed-for brothers and sisters, my joy and my crown, here's my first piece of advice. In this manner, stand firm in the Lord, dear friends. You call yourself a Christian? Is it easy to act like a Christian, to be a Christian? Yeah. I had a conversation with somebody this past week, and it was a tough conversation. And so I had to call the person and say, you know what, I'm just sorry that I was so harsh. Stand firm in the Lord. Our commitment is to Jesus Christ. Lord, the most important thing is that I do your will. Trying to please Jesus. The song we used to sing was living for Jesus. A life that is true. Striving to please him in all that I do. And that's what the Christian life is about. So that's the first step toward getting peace. Don't leave this one out. It is, as I said, as far as I'm concerned, the most important. It's kind of like the old expression, or I'd see it on a bumper sticker. No, it would say no God. It didn't say no Jesus, but it would say K-N-O-W, know, like to know. If you know God, you'll know peace. But then it follows up and it says, if you don't have a God, N-O, God, no God. N-O, no peace. It's kind of a play on words, but it's so true. If you're going to get peace, you're going to need the peace that comes from God. The Apostle Paul, I'm sure that as he sat there in the prison, not knowing from day to day, of course, he writes here that he believes that he's going to be released from prison. He's already spent 2 years in prison. You know, but every day to live with the uncertainty of not knowing whether or not they were going to come in and take your life. The Apostle Paul could live with peace because he said, you know what? I've lived, you know, depending upon the Lord. And the Lord has always been faithful. And if the Lord decides to call me home, everything is right between me and him. And that's where our peace, first and foremost, is going to come from. The second part of today's lesson, let's get another reader here. Clyde, you want to, Mrs. W?
Yeah,
ladies,
I'm working on this.
I'm working on these words.
Okay, good for
okay.
You. There's some doozies.
Yeah, I urge Odia, and I urge Sin to Key to agree in the Lord. Yes, I also ask you, true partner, to help these women who have contend for the gospel at my side, along with Clement and rest of all my co-workers whose names are in the book of life.
Okay, very good.
Yeah, I
and
had
I
it
don't...
on a recording and I kept going, I said, why can't I?
I learned that all morning.
Yeah. But that's something that I can really get it down. But and that Odia, it looks like it should be pronounced different than that.
Well, I've always heard it pronounced Euodia, kind of like the EU, like a eulogy, EU,
yeah.
Euodia. Yeah. But who knows how you pronounce these? I know we've got all these pronunciation experts, but I end up thinking, how did they pronounce it back then? You know, you go back 2,000 years, are you sure that they pronounced it that way? But the important thing is that we know these two people's names, and it was, in defense of my earlier statements, it was two women, because he does say, help these women who have contended in my side, help them to agree in the Lord. Apparently, there was disagreement. And let me say, at times there will be disagreements. What is the expression that we sometimes use? I'm trying to think how it's phrased. It's along these lines, trying to be brutally honest without being brutal. You know, there will be differences. You do understand that that's where all of the different church denominations came from.
How do you say the second one?
I always heard Sintichi, but yeah, I heard Sintichi, but I don't know.
Above there, I broke it down so I could get it. Yeah, it's in the front book.
Okay.
But I got them on my phone, and I just kept repeating them all over. Syntyche.
Yeah, they pronounce it syntyche, yeah, with the emphasis on the sin. Syntyche.
Yeah,
syntyche. But anyhow, there was disagreement, and I was telling you about the denominations because I'm using them as an illustration to say that there won't always be agreement. There won't always be agreement. There will be disagreements. But you need to do it in such a way that the Lord is honored. I understand, and this was back when I was in seminary, you know, close to 40 years ago. It's hard to believe it's been that long. But my church history professor at the time, Dr. Bill Leonard, said that back then there were around 50 different types of Baptists. I have no idea how many more there are now. But how do all of these things happen? Because there are disagreements. Please understand this. What this point of the lesson is trying to emphasize is that if you unite, there tends to be peace. You divide, there tends to be tension. And so he's trying to encourage these people to lay aside their differences and work at uniting. Now, sometimes, you know, division is it's impossible not to divide. But work toward unity. What do you do to help try to bring people together? What are some of the things that you've used in your life to help bring family members together? What are some of the things that you've used to help yourself overcome the differences with other people? Have you had differences with other people? Of course, but then none of them come to mind at this point. Hey, Chuck, you remember when you told Clyde that he was cruising? Clyde, you want to return the favor?
You didn't know what to get.
It's interesting,
that's
both
the
these
best
guys.
Thing, Clyde.
Both these guys sitting there next to each other with their black trousers on and their gray shirts.
Oh, they do, they match. Like, yeah.
They are true brothers this morning. I say they're true brothers. At Chuck's age, he's more like a grandfather, Clyde, but.
Yeah. I might even be a great grandfather.
Yeah.
You are great.
You are great.
You didn't hear that one.
I was thinking today about something I read. I forget what it was, but Gene Haught's brother, Bill Schaefer,
mm-hmm.
We were almost the same age. We lived close together. We were like two natural brothers. Even if we were away from each other for years, when we saw each other the next time, we were happy to see each other.
You pick up right where you left off.
And that's fine. That's fine for people that you get along with. You know, there's a picture I know when we came here for, what was it, your 80th or whatnot. And there was a picture in here of you and Bill Schaefer sitting in a washtub together back when you were just little guys. It's one thing to have that kind of thing where you get along with people and there's never any disagreement. What I'm asking, though, is what do you do when there is disagreement? What are some of the tools that you and I can use to help bring together? You know, for instance, you may think that I'm just a wacko preacher, I get that. But why do oftentimes try to implement humor? And I know y'all say, and it's poor at that. But why do I try to implement it? Is because people that laugh together tend to get along together.
Laugh together, stay together.
Yeah, very much so. So, humor can be one of those things. It can be one of those things of stay away from those subjects that you know are going to be divisive. Mm-hmm. It could be that you buy somebody a gift. You know, the Proverbs talks about a gift opens up doors to the king, and it's amazing how much stuff is going on these days through bribery, and I'm not encouraging bribery because bribery perverts justice. It perverts justice. But still, a gift is one of those things that helps to build relationships. You know, you see something and you just buy it for somebody that maybe somebody that isn't exactly on your love list, but you're thinking about them, and it doesn't have to be anything major, but you just give it to them just as an expression, or cook them something, or, you know, ask about what's going on in their life. How is the situation that you are dealing with? And I just throw these things out there because these are typically tools that can be used to help bring people together, to unite rather than divide. And the Apostle Paul is saying to these two women and to the other church members, Clement and the rest of them, why don't you do something to try to bring people together? Mm-hmm. And I was asking, were there certain things that you did?
Maybe. Yes, there is. I have a close cousin, and I talked to her about Christianity, and she said, I have my relationship with God, but I don't go to church, and it's none of your business. So we ignore that question. We don't talk about it. She has her relationship, didn't want to talk about it. So, and we're just as close as we can be, but we don't talk about that. But in recent years, I have seen a drawing closer to God. I can see it. I don't think she goes to church yet, but she still is. I can see her drawing closer to God. So we didn't know.
Okay.
I didn't know. But ignore the situation and go on. You can still be happy and at peace with people.
Yeah.
And not talk about the things that they don't want to talk about.
Okay. Good illustration.
They say you shouldn't talk about religion or politics with somebody, you know, when you're having a family.
Right.
Because nobody's going to totally agree with what God's
saying.
I've seen
families split there with the politics thing.
I know I had an uncle, and when him and my dad would get together, my uncle would bring up politics. And then they would get into a big argument. So I learned when I was pretty young, you know, that's shouldn't be talking like that with somebody that don't agree with you. It's okay if the other people are the same as, you know, agrees on a lot of stuff. But when you get someone that's totally, that you can't tell anything to, they get mad right now.
I know, we've oftentimes heard the statement, you know, religion and politics don't mix. And I think for the most part, when you're dealing with individuals, you know where people stand, and it's just going to bring it. Now, let me tell you, and I'm not trying to just offer a defense here from a pastoral standpoint, but when it comes to the church continues to have to take a godly stand on the things that are right and the things that are wrong. And let me say this about politics. Politics reflects what you believe is right and what's wrong.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so, you know, some people would say, you know, you need to do, as a pastor, you just need to avoid all these political issues. Well, you know what?
You can't.
You can't ignore it. You absolutely can't. If the church ignores, you know, the abortion, they ignore the homosexuality, the transgenderism, they ignore, you know, defunding the police, they ignore everything, and they don't want to offend anybody. They tell you what, the Word of God is offensive. I'm not intentionally trying to create division with the church, but I tell you what I am trying to do is to keep the church from becoming just absolutely worthless. Because Jesus says, if the salt has lost its saltiness, it is good for nothing but to be cast out and trampled under the feet of men. And I'll tell you this much, there's a lot of churches these days that have absolutely become worthless.
Yeah.
I know that I'm not sure which branch of the Lutheran church, but they just ordained their first transgendered person as the head of the church. I'll tell you what. The church has a responsibility to still speak the truth.
Oh, yeah.
You know, if the people are coming into the church and they're not willing to accept that, I'm not trying to run anybody off. But I tell you what, you're going to have a sad day to stand before God if you're embracing those things that upset God, because God has made it known through His Word how He feels about sin. It is something that He hates. And if you love sin, you don't belong in His kingdom. I'm not trying to be ugly. I'm just telling you.
I think if you know in your heart right from wrong, if you're a Christian, you surely know right from wrong.
Except the Apostle Paul, in writing to the church, the Christians at Rome, he said that those people, you know, because they had engaged in so much that God had basically seared their conscience, so that they no longer recognized right from wrong. And I agree with you, a person that, you know, should understand what's right and wrong. But, so I'm just kind of offering that. Some people might say with this thing of unity, you know, just don't address anything that unifies. And I'm going to point back to John the Baptist. You know, John the Baptist, when he was outside Jerusalem over at the Jordan River baptizing, people came to him. Did he say, "All you people are just so wonderful. You're doing such a great job"? Is that what John the Baptist did? Is it what he did? He called sin, sin, especially to the religious leaders. Says, "You brood of vipers, I'm not going to pat you on the back. I'm going to tell you what God is upset. In fact, the axe is already at the root of the tree, and judgment is coming. You better repent." So let me say, yeah, maybe within our homes, within our families, you know where people are standing. But within the church, there, I don't know that there's been a greater need these days for the church to stand up for what's right. And so much of what we're talking about, what's right, deals with political issues. And I will say this much. Go ahead and come and try to take our tax-exempt status away. I'm not going to keep my mouth shut. You folks at the IRS don't employ me. I'm employed by God. And if I see that you're trying to force us to accept stuff that's against God's word, you're not going to silence me by saying, "Oh, you're getting outside of what the church is allowed to do." As employed by God, I have a responsibility to say what God wants me to say. I look at the camera when I say that because I want to send a message loud and clear. We have a responsibility to preach the truth. And I'll tell you this much. So much of what's being promoted right now by our government, you're going to bring the judgment of God down even harder on this nation. When you read about Sodom and Gomorrah, when you read about the flooding of the earth, you folks can pretend that God doesn't exist, but I tell you what, within this church, we believe that God does exist and that God will judge.
Amen.
Amen.
And I don't want to see or experience the judgment of God. It's not because I hate the sinners. It's I hate the sin because God knows what it does to these people's lives.
In the last few months, we've had issues in our house that we had to have somebody come and fix them. And I asked them, after we were there a while, when I get to know them a little bit, I'll say, "Are you a Christian?" Both cases, we had water problem. Both young men were Christians. They said they were. And Friday...
You could tell that they were.
Yeah. And then, I guess Thursday or Friday of this week, a lady came and did some measuring for us. And I said, "Are you a Christian?" She said, "Yes." I said, "Do you have children?" She said, "Yes." I said, "Do they go to church?" She said she had four girls. She said they go to the Catholic Church, but she said they go to church.
Good.
But I usually, if I know a person well enough, which I don't know many, I'll make sure that I ask them if they're a Christian.
Good.
And if they don't give me a right answer, I drop it, because you don't want to press too hard sometimes.
I understand.
In all these cases, in these three people that came to our house, they both, all three said, "Yes, I'm a Christian." So, what can you do from there?
Accept it.
Yeah, that's what I do.
Agree.
Good.
And so I'm just saying that there is a time for unity. Keep in mind our study from Ecclesiastes last quarter. There's a time for every purpose under heaven. There is both a time to speak up and a time to be quiet. There is a time to bring together. There's a time to separate. That God might give us. So as I preach this about unity, please understand that unity is one of those things that gives us peace. Have you all had friction where there's been breakups of relationships, maybe between you and your spouse, and you've been upset with each other, or between you and your children? Is there peace? No, the peace comes whenever the two of you are able to get back together. You know, but at times I just want to say, there comes a time that you may have to take a stand and say, you know what, we'll just have to be divided on this. And it hurts. It hurts. But your peace is going to come from knowing in your heart that I'm right with God, and that's what's most important. I cannot continue to just allow this to go on, because it's something that is very offensive to God. It is something that is harmful, and I can't go along with it. And you will still have peace, even though you may not have unity with the person. You will have peace in your heart. Okay? Good enough on that one? So the first one is stand. The second one is unite. The third one is
pray.
Who would like to read this one out loud? Will you, Miss Bessie? Thank you.
Rejoice in the Lord always,
and
again I say rejoice.
Amen. She's singing. And she does it as a round, so we come in on the echo parts.
That's not the way she talks at home.
Let your graciousness be known to everybody, everyone. The Lord is near. Don't worry about anything, but in everything, through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Okay, so the third one, and I'm going to add this before we deal with pray. He says rejoice. In other words, get happy. I don't feel like being happy. Well, again, I'll use Ecclesiastes. There is a time to dance. There's a time to mourn. There's a time for happiness. But learn to rejoice. Rejoice what? Rejoice in the Lord. What does that mean? It means that the Lord has it all under control. You and I can rejoice. It doesn't mean that, you know, it's good. Had this conversation this past week. Person says, you know, that they try not to allow anything to bother them. And I know this may sound really good. They try not to allow anything to bother them because God's in control. And I just try to caution this person. I don't want to develop a flippant attitude toward trials and adversity. Did Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane just rejoice in the Lord always and just say, well, doesn't matter to me. God's in control. As he goes off to be nailed to the cross. Is that what Jesus did? It agonized. They say, don't ignore real feelings. He said to this person about, was God in control? Let me ask you a question. Was God in control when 6 million Jews were sent to concentration camps and gassed to death in Nazi Germany? Was God in control? So we should just rejoice as these people go off to the gas chambers. No. Was God in control when this country was under British rule and the British were making life unbearable for us here in America? Was God in control? Did God just say, well, you shouldn't be suffering, just be thankful that I'm in control? No, we had people that said, you know, the time of us being knuckled under all this, it's time to rise up. And I guarantee there was a lot of stress. Rejoicing in the Lord means that you're willing to stand up for what's right regardless. Rejoice that your strength is in the Lord and his righteousness. And then, after he tells you to rejoice in the Lord, he talks about prayer. But before he says about prayer, verse 6, first four words. Don't worry about
anything.
Don't worry about anything. tell you, that's tough. That is tough.
I used to I have done better with my worrying, because I worried about everything.
Yeah, I worried about you.
Yeah, I mean, seriously, I mean, you know, if like one of the kids would go somewhere, I would worry, and that was before all the cell phones and everything. Well, did they make it there, you know, and then that they'd be a little bit late, and, you know, something happened. I always jumped to the worst thing, but I have gotten...
Age has a lot to do with that. You just don't remember all
Jim Brock, the pastor that was here way before, he told me, he goes, that's a sin to worry, and I go, well, I'm the biggest sinner around because I worry all the time. And so I have got better. I mean, I still sometimes worry about certain things.
What's it say in the Bible?
I know. Oh, I know.
We just read it here. Don't worry about anything. Yeah. We're not supposed to worry.
That's
and it's tough.
It is.
Instead of worrying, he goes on to say, instead of worrying, pray.
Well, I wrote down to this, find things to be thankful for.
Find things to be thankful for. That's one of the things. But he also says, present your request to God. Know that you're bringing those before God. God is hearing those things. And God is listening and God is acting. You may not see God's hand at work, but you know the heart of God, that God cares for us as his children. And he's heard you and he's working on it. So he says, it's one of those things. Rather than worrying and causing yourself a lot of distress and not to have peace, pray. Pray. And he says, God will be able to put his peace in your heart. You'll know that you've talked with God and you say, well, God, I'm not seeing what you're doing right now. And God says to you, okay, do you trust me? Do you trust me that you've asked me for something? Do you think that I would just totally ignore you? Or do you think, based upon what you've been through in your life, do you think that I can be trusted? Have there ever been those times in your life that I've seen you through? Have any of those things in the past ever managed to destroy you yet? No. Okay, God, I trust in you. And it says that the peace of God, it may surpass all understandings. I don't understand, but he's going to guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And I know there are times, I just heard the little dangling over there. I mean, we appreciate our dangling.
I'm just a fill-in.
You're just a fill-in. Would you like to read the last passage of Scripture for us? And of course, the other one was pray, stand, unite, pray, and then the last one is what?
Dwell. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any moral excellence, and if there is anything praiseworthy, dwell on these things. Do what you have learned and received and heard from me and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you.
Okay, I'm going to offer a little disclaimer here. I'm going to get knocked in the head for doing it. It appears that what the Apostle Paul is saying in this passage of Scripture, find, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there's any moral excellence, if there's anything praiseworthy, dwell on these things. It seems like he's saying, just look up and think happy thoughts and think about good things. And here's the disclaimer I'm going to add. While that may help us to some degree, I am also reminded in Scripture of especially the Old Testament prophets that they would fast and pray. And it was I look at it as a stressful time for them. You know, because they did without many times food and water because it was something that was gnawing at them. It wasn't one of those things they just kind of brushed everything aside and said, you know what? In order to do what Scripture says, I just need to put on a happy face and just think happy thoughts. And I probably mouth shut. Once again, I'll run it when I probably shouldn't. But that's been one of the criticisms of Joel Osteen's ministry. Let's just think about everything positive. Let's be very positive and happy about stuff. Let me say, please don't be artificial.
Well, Paul was in prison when he wrote that, wasn't he?
He is.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, he was in a bad time when he was going through this.
I think if you've got a problem, or if you're in a bad situation, you first you pray, and then you think on these things, and you turn it over to God. You turn it over to God first, and then let Him handle it.
Well,
don't worry about it. Let Him take care of it, Janet.
And let me say, maybe I mischaracterized this list of things that he says for you to think about. Because when you start to think about this, these are holy, righteous things. That your strength is found in the righteousness and holiness of God. Where it talks about whatever is true. You're not going to find peace if you're thinking about lies. You know, I'm so fed up with the lies. You better start thinking about the stuff. These are characteristics, qualities of the God that we serve. So maybe I mischaracterize it when I say, you know, all this list is about happy thoughts. It is about those things that are pleasing in God's sight. Keep thinking about those things that are true. I'll just ask this question. Do you think that John the Baptist ever sat in prison and said, oh, I just wish that I'd have never said that about Herod and his wife Herodias? Or do you think that John the Baptist sat there in prison and said, you know what? I can live with myself because I said what God wanted me to say. I know that it wasn't received very well, but I spoke what was true. You will have peace in having said what is true. I don't believe that John the Baptist said it in hate toward King Herod. I think he said it to King Herod out of love. Hey, Herod, you realize that what you did by taking your brother's wife, you're going to have to give an account to God for it.
He was.
It's whatever is true. Whatever is honorable. Let me tell you what. I've been following the news. I don't know if you followed it or not. There's a lieutenant colonel. The guy had 17 years in with the military after he watched the debacle of what took place in Afghanistan, where they walked away and they, you know, led to the loss of countless lives, 13 American soldiers in particular, but others as well. He was absolutely dumbfounded by the way that the leadership handled this situation. Because, I mean, we've only been over there, what, 20-some years? And you mean to tell me this is the best that we could do? And he openly questioned. He questioned. He recorded it on the internet, put it out there. He says, listen, I know that I'm probably going to get court-martialed for saying this. He says, I can't live with myself unless I speak up. So he spoke up, and guess what? Not only they yanked him, and he told him, he says, when I speak up, the courts of Mars will mean all these years, I'm going to lose my pension, I'm going to lose it all. He said, but I have to do the thing that is honorable. So right now, guess what they've done to him? He's in solitary confinement, been there for, I don't know, maybe a week or 2 weeks, something like that. He may be in there for 3 years. I mean, they're talking about he did the honorable thing. And the Apostle Paul says, look, if you're going to have peace, it's not just thinking the happy thoughts. It means doing the thing that is right. Think about the honorable thing. By the way, I read this morning, or yesterday, I can't remember which of the two, that it's kind of like a GoFundMe. I don't know that GoFundMe is the organization that's doing it, but they've already raised $2 million for this guy to help pay legal expenses and other things like that. So he says, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, you know, I want you to focus on those things that are outstanding, God. It makes you wonder, the Apostle Paul, he's already spent 2 years of his life in prison in Caesarea. Now he's more than likely in Rome. Who knows how long he's been in prison in Rome. You think that he ever sits back and says, boy, oh boy, what a dummy I was. Why did I ever go and, you know, make that trip back to Jerusalem to take that relief offering? If I'd have never gone back there and had anything to do to try to help those people, I'd have avoided all that. The Apostle Paul says, no, I felt like that's what God wanted me to do. I was faithful to do what God wanted me to do. And And I think that's why we read later on, as he wrote to Timothy, he says, I finished my course. I finished my race. You know, I've done what I want to do. There's peace in these things. And the Apostle Paul says, you do these things and you will find, dwell in them. Make them the focus of your life. And then you will have peace when as you, you know, face whatever the future holds. So, anyhow, the lesson today was stand in the Lord, try to be united, pray, and the last but not least, dwell on those things that are honorable to God. There's a list of things here. Do you have any questions? I know we've got to go dangling over there, getting ready to ring.
Ring your bell.
And let me tell you what. Have y'all ever met her son? She knows a lot about dangling. Let's have prayer. Father, we do want your peace. And we'll admit that many times we are distressed. But we pray that you help us to take to heart the instructions that we've received today of how we can have peace. Because if we don't need it right now, there are coming times that we are going to be stressed. Help us to be able to recall these instructions. And Father, may your peace be not only present in our lives all the time, but be visible to those around us. That people will say, when they see us going through so much, how is it that you're able to keep your wits about you? We could say, well, it's not us, it's the peace that we get from you. We ask, Father, that you bless the service to Father and pray that you might be honored. Have your will and your way in everything that's said and done. Bring us back this next week. And until then, use us for your glory in Jesus.